Good morning and welcome back to the next class. So in the previous class, we were discussing about something like how this the small static CMOS inverter can be made with the help of two different transistors like PMOS and NMOS transistors. And in the operation of all these transistors, both the transistors, that depends on what is the input and what is the VGS and what are the different conditions. Okay, so we also know that, like, here we have the characteristics, ID VGS characteristics for both the PMOS and NMOS transistors, and we saw that if the VGS is greater than the threshold voltage for the NMOS transistor, in that case we will assume that the device is in the on state. And similarly for the PMOS transistor, if the threshold voltage is if the VGS is less than the threshold voltage, then the PMOS will be in on state. Okay, so this is the two conditions, and by which by seeing this, we come up with, like, based on the two input possible input combinations, like Vin is equal to 0 volt and Vin is equal to VDD, we saw, like, the output voltage of this circuit, this can be the VDD, or it could be like grounded. So if you see here, in case of Vin is equal to 0 volt, simply this VDD is going to be transferred, so the V out will be nothing but this will be equal to the VDD. Okay, now if you see here in the second case, like if we have provided Vin is equal to VDD, so this NMOS transistor was in the on state, and if this NMOS transistor is in on state, so this V out will be discharged to this ground. So I am assuming that this V out will be nothing volt, but this will be the 0 volt. Okay, so this is the two different states in the CMOS circuit. Okay, and this is really very important to understand. Okay, now let us come up with few of the points that is really very important if I'm considering the CMOS inverter. Okay, so the first and very important point is, like, the here we have considered two logic levels. The first logic level is 0 and 1, and for 0 we have provided ground, and for the 1 we have provided VDD. Okay, so here we can assume that, because the very important thing, like, if I have provided the input at logic 0, in that case this PMOS transistor will be in on state. And if, yeah, so let me write which one is the PMOS and which one is the NMOS. Might be you will not be able to understand. So this is the PMOS and this is the NMOS. Okay, so if Vin is equal to 0, in that case PMOS will be in the on state, and the property of the MOSFET is, if the device is in on state, the resistance across this device is very low. Okay, and the vice versa. So if the device is in the off state, the resistance is very high. So if the resistance is low, we are assuming that there is a minimum, like there will be a small resistance, means the maximum voltage that will be transferred to the output. So whatever the VDD we have provided, that will be transferred to the output. And similarly, for the NMOS, if I have provided logic 0 at the input side, in that case, the NMOS transistor will be in on state, and this V out, or whatever the capacitance we have connected over here, like the output capacitance, that will be discharged through this NMOS transistor. And because the, so this is how we can calculate. Because see, yeah, I will explain you in detail. So this is the simply the ideal case, whatever I have just explained. But in practical, it is not possible that if the device is in on state, there will be zero resistance. It is not possible. There is some on resistance, and that on resistance depends on the W by L. I think you can recall in the if you can recall 3 classes back, you will be able to understand. We calculated one transconductance and one resistance, on resistance of the device, and that was the function of W by L. Okay, so by changing W by L, you can simply change the on resistance. Okay, so what it means in practical, in reality, it is not just like a short circuited. The structure will look like this one. Okay, so let me draw the structure for the practical case. So if Vin is equal to zero, so let me draw the diagram again. So I need to do some modification. Okay, so okay, no issue. So if Vin is equal to 0 volt or logic zero, in that case we have assumed like the PMOS transistor will be in on state, so the circuit will look like this one. See, this is the R on, and here we will have some open circuited, okay, and that will be grounded, and here we will observe some output voltage, and there will be some load capacitance. This load capacitance is basically the capacitive effect that comes from the other circuit which is connected after this inverter, right? So like suppose, let us assume I have a simple inverter and I am driving this inverter, like I am driving the fan out of this inverter. Let us assume the fan out of the first inverter is 2. So this will drive 2 inverters. So whatever the input capacitance this inverter will draw, and the second, similarly, whatever the input capacitance of this inverter is, in combination, we will get some capacitive effect over here. And that capacitive effect is nothing but this is the input capacitance of whatever the circuit I have connected at the output side. And that capacitive effect will act as a load capacitance for this first inverter. Okay, so this is the simple concept why I am keeping CL over here. See, the important thing is this CL play an important role, especially if I am talking about the delay. Okay, so this CL, if the CL is very low, in that case, the RC time constant will be very less. Okay, so if the RC time constant is low, means the charging and discharging will be faster. Okay, so less capacitance, the charging and discharging will be faster. So the rise time and the fall time can be reduced. Let me say it again. So, and then I will go to there. Otherwise, okay, let me explain here only. So you will get some idea. So as I'm saying, like, what is this, how this CL comes? So this CL comes just from how many circuits I am driving from a particular inverter or particular circuit, and whatever the input capacitance or the resultant input capacitance is there, that input capacitance, that is the nothing, it is the load capacitance for this input inverter. Okay, and this load capacitance decide what is the RC time constant for charging and the discharging. Okay, so for to charge this, what will be the output, that depends on what is the capacitance. So the charging and discharging time constant depends on this CL, and if somehow we are able to manage this CL as small as possible, in that case, we can say the charging and discharging time constant is low. So the rise time, suppose I'm giving some input to any of the inverter. So this rise time and the fall time, that will be also be reduced. Okay, so whatever this fall time and the rise time we will face, that will be more sharper. Okay, so you will get more ideal waveform or ideal characteristics. So this is what the importance of this capacitance is. Okay, and here we have a research challenge, like how we can reduce the input capacitance of any circuit. So this is one of the research challenges, so that we can reduce the capacitance, and subsequently delay can be reduced, and that can be utilized for high performance applications. Okay, so here we have some research problem that could be done. So yes, so now we got the point from where I just wrote this CL. Okay, because this CL comes from, suppose I am driving some of the circuits which is connected to this output voltage, then this CL will be there. So this CL will come into the picture. Okay, so this is how this load capacitance will look like. And then if you talk about, like, because see, if I am providing input is equal to zero, in that case, this PMOS transistor is on, and this load capacitance is going to charge through this on resistance. Okay, so during the Vin is equal to zero, we will get some RC time constant or charging time constant TC, and that is the function of R on and CL. So this charging time constant is the function of R on and CL. So as I told you, this charging time constant, and similarly, let me explain the second case as well. Then I will tell you what is the importance. If Vin is equal to VDD, okay, if I'm providing Vin is equal to VDD, in that case, the circuit will look like this. This the PMOS transistor will be on state. So there will be an open switch, be a high resistance. And here we will have some resistance, which is the R on. Let us assume this is for N and this is for P. Okay. And here I will get some output. Okay. And here I will have some load capacitance CL. Okay. Now this during this second phase, like if Vin if Vin is equal to VDD, this pull down transistor or this driver transistor will be activated. So this capacitor will be discharged through this this resistance, which is from the NMOS side. Okay. So here we will have some discharging time constant, and that depends on R on N into CL. This depends on R on P into CL. So now the very important thing is, if I want to make equal rise time in the fall time, okay? If I want to make equal rise time in the fall time, in this case, because we have a common load capacitance for both the operations, like rise time and the fall time, but we have a two different resistances for the charging and the discharging. Okay, for charging we have the PMOS on resistance, and for discharging we have the NMOS on resistance. Okay, so this, the charging and discharging time constant, that completely depends on what is the size of PMOS and NMOS transistor. Okay, and one more thing, this is really very important to understand, like just please pay attention to what I'm saying. As we know that the PMOS and NMOS transistors are two different kind of MOSFETs having the different majority charge carriers. In PMOS transistor, we have the holes in the majority, and in the NMOS transistor, we have the electrons in the majority charge carrier. Okay. And we know that the mobility of electron and hole is not equal. There is some change. There is the mobility of electron is approximately 2.25 to 2.5 times higher than the holes. Okay. So this much of, like, we know that, like, mobility of hole, mobility of electrons is equal to 2.25 to, let me write it properly, mobility of electron is 2.25 to 2.5 times of mobility of holes. Okay, so this is important thing. Now what will happen if I will keep the transistor sizing of PMOS transistor and NMOS transistor equal? Okay, if I will keep equal W by L ratio for both the PMOS and NMOS transistors, in this case we cannot make R on P is equal to R on N. And if you are not able to make these two resistances equal, then the charging time constant and the discharging time constant will not be equal. Let me repeat it again. We know that the mobility of electron is approximately 2.25 to 2.5 times of mobility of holes. Okay. And if it is like that, in that case, R on for both the devices will not be equal. And if it is not equal, TC and TD will not be equal. So what we can do? We need to increase the size of one of the transistor having less mobility so that we can have equal current flow by increasing the current, because we also know that the drain current which is flowing through the device, that is also the function of W by L. And if somehow we are able to increase the W by L of the device, we can increase the current flowing through it, and the mobility means and by that way we can manage to make equal current through both the devices. Okay, so what we need to do? We need to increase the size of this PMOS transistor by approximately 2.25 times to 2.5 times so that we can have the equal current that will flow through the PMOS and NMOS transistor. And if it is like that, the on resistance for both the devices will be matched, and the charging and the discharging time constant will also be equal. So there will be no mismatch. Okay, so there will be symmetricity in charging and the discharging. So this is really very important. And in detail, we will see later on again, what is the impact of sizing and how this noise margin will be altered and other thing. So we'll see in detail later on. Just but for your understanding, just I have given you a brief explanation of all these things. Okay, so these two are the important relation.
Sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, how is that? Where is that CL coming from? Why is it common to both?
Yeah, so this CL is coming. I just explained these things before, but let me explain it again. Okay. So suppose I have an inverter circuit. Okay. Simple inverter circuit. I have this one. And let us assume the fan out of this inverter circuit is, let us assume it is, for example, it is 3. Okay. What it means, I am driving 3 other inverters from the output of this first inverter. Okay, fan out is nothing but how many circuits this can drive. Any circuit can drive is the fan out. Okay, so let us assume the fan out of this inverter, which is in the dark shade. The fan out of this inverter is, let us assume 3. Okay, so every inverter, yeah, the connected output inverter have some input capacitance. Okay, why input capacitance? Because if you see this inverter circuit here, in this inverter circuit, we have a MOS capacitor. Like here, we have the MOS structure. And if the MOS structure is there, gate to source, gate to drain, gate to bulk, and other kind of capacitance will be there. So if this kind of capacitances are there, at the input side of inverter, we will assume there is some input capacitance. Okay, so if there is some input capacitance of any inverter or any circuit, it's not just like inverter, it could be any circuit. Okay, so I'm just for a simplicity, I have just taken the reference like I am considering inverter. So there will be some input resistance of this inverter, there will be input capacitance of this inverter, and there will be input capacitance of this inverter as well. And if I see here, there are 3 capacitors that are connected in the parallel. So if they are connected in the parallel, their resultant capacitive effect will be increased. Okay, we know that if I'm connecting capacitors in parallel, the capacitance will increase. Okay, so in result, let us assume all these capacitances are C-dash. So what I will get? I will get the total capacitance at the output of this first inverter will be 3 times of C-dash, and that I'm considering is the load capacitance. So this load capacitance is nothing but whatever the circuit I have connected at the output of any circuit, and how many capacitance we are observing at the input side of all the output, all the circuit which I have connected, that is nothing but that will treat as a load capacitance of this inverter. Okay, similarly, yes, sir, for, got it. You got it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so this is how we can consider like where the load capacitance is. One very important thing. Like it is not necessary that the load capacitance of all the inverters will be same. Why it is so? Let me explain these things. I will take the complete lecture on this, but yes, because you asked the question, so I need to answer it perfectly. So let us assume the fan out of the first inverter is 3, and let us assume the fan out of this inverter is, let us assume 2. Okay, and all these, the property of all the inverters are same. So So in that case, if I'm assuming that both all the inverters are same, so I will assume CL dash over here as well and CL dash over here as well. So the load capacitance for this inverter will be only 2 times of CL dash, C dash. Okay. So it is not necessary that the load capacitance of equal size inverter will always be equal. No, it is not like that. It completely depends on how many, what is the fan out, what kind of circuits I have connected at the output side. Okay. So this is important. Okay. Fine. So I'm hoping you got the answer, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So this is all about how we can mesh the things. Now let us move ahead with the more details about. Yeah. Before moving into the details, let me consider a few more things. Yeah, I'm very slow in teaching, and I used to take a single slide to explain for the longer time, because this is only slide number 3 and I have taken 1.5 hours. So yesterday I started with the slide number 1 and I have reached at 3 only. So yeah, so but I used to explain all the things in detail. Okay, so this is important. A number of slides are not important. Okay, fine. So yeah, let us move ahead with the things. Like suppose in the previous lecture, yesterday's lecture, let me recall a few things. Here we saw that in this particular graph, we saw that if the input is half of the VDD, whatever we have provided, in that case, I will assume that the output will be high. And if the input is greater than VDD by 2 and up to VDD, the output will be low. So this is how inverter works. But the question is, if I have a CMOS inverter, I have two different kind of MOSFETs, like PMOS and NMOS devices. In that case, how this kind of behavior is coming, like how these regions are coming and what are the different operating conditions of both the devices. And that is really very important to understand how we got to know that the behavior will be like this only. Why the behavior is not like this? Okay, why the behavior is like not like this? Why I am getting the behavior like this kind of, and how we can change the behavior from here to somewhere here or somewhere here. So what are those parameters which are responsible to change the characteristics? So we will see here now. Okay. So I just made the theme what we are going to study. So let us talk about the transferring IV characteristics of PMOS transistor. Before I go into the detail, let me explain how the ID VDS characteristics of both the NMOS and PMOS transistors look like. Okay, so we know that the ID VDS characteristics, this is the ID and this is the VDS. So ID VDS characteristics of NMOS transistors looks like this. So if I'm changing the VGS, then the structure will look like this. This is the lowest VGS, and here I'm increasing the VGS. Okay, so this is how the IDVDS characteristics of NMOS transistors look like. Okay, so suppose let us assume here we have an inverter. Okay, and if we have an inverter something like this, so we have two kind of devices, and the IDVDS characteristics of NMOS transistors looks like this, whereas the IDVD characteristics of the PMOS transistors look like this. Okay, so because the polarity is opposite, so it required negative gate to source voltage or something like that. So the VGS is decreasing in this direction, or magnitude of VGS is increasing in this direction. And the quadrant is also opposite let me explain a few more things. Like, see why the coordinate is different. Like if you see here, the IDS for P is nothing but this is opposite to IDS of N, because the direction of current will be opposite to each other. In one device, the direction will be from source to drain, and in other device, the direction will be drain to source. Okay, because of the different majority charge carriers. So there will be mismatch in this one, but if somehow I want to match these two scales, like ID VDS characteristics work for both the PMOS and NMOS transistor. So in the red, I have drawn the ID VDS characteristics for the NMOS transistor. And at the bottom here, we have the ID VDS characteristics for the PMOS transistors. But if I just want to operate these both the devices in a single circuit, I need to match the scale of both the things. Okay, so how we can match it? To match it, because we know that IDSP is negative of IDSN. So what we need to do? So suppose if somehow we can flip this one, like IDN is equal to minus IDDP. So it will be something like this. So suppose, and because after flipping, I need to add the VDD with VGSP as well, as so that I will get the other cycle. Okay. And once I got this, then what I need to do, I need to shift it from somewhere further. I need to shift the VDSP as well. And if to get the output, because the output is nothing but this is a drain to source voltage. Okay. So that will be the VDSP. Okay. So if VDS is equal to zero, see here, if VDSP is equal to zero, output will be VDD. So VDSP is equal to zero means what? The drain to source voltage drop across this PMOS transistor is zero. Means I'm assuming that the voltage drop across this PMOS transistor will be zero only if this PMOS transistor is in the on state. Let me recall it again. Okay. Let me go to the all the points and then let me write again a few more things. Like this is the gate terminal. This is the gate terminal. This is the source terminal. This is the drain terminal. This is the drain terminal. And this is the source terminal. Because the direction is opposite. That is why we have kept like IDSP is equal to minus of IDSN. Okay. Other things. If I'm talking about VGS for the N, VGS for N is nothing but this is the input whatever I am providing. So this VGS of N is nothing but this is the input. Similarly, the VGS for P is nothing but this is the V in minus of VDD. Okay, so V in minus VDD is the VGSP. Similarly, let us talk about the VDS so that we can match all those things. Okay, VDSN is nothing but here we have this will be the V out minus zero, and that will become the V output. Okay. And VDS for P, that will be VDS is nothing but here we have the V out minus VDD. So if you see here,
VGSN and VGSP, can you explain that?
VGSN and VGSP. Okay. So here, if I'm talking about VGS for N, so this is the gate terminal, this is the source terminal, and source is grounded and gate is nothing but this is the V input. So VGS N will be V in minus zero, and that will be V in. Similarly, VGS P means this is the gate terminal, this one is the source terminal, here we have the source terminal, gate terminal is V in and the source terminal is VDD. So VGS P will become V in minus VDD.
Yes, clear.
Okay. And similarly, you can calculate for the VDS. Okay. So now we have all these equations for the IDSP and all the parameters. Okay. So if you see here in this diagram, we have two different ID VDS characteristics. Okay. And if we have two different ID VDS characteristics, what I need to do, because there is a mismatch in the scale. In one, it is in the other quadrant, and in for the PMOS, it is in other quadrant, right? So we need to match the quadrant, and we also need to match all other things so that we can merge these two things to get the actual behavior how the inverter looked like. Okay, and for that purpose, what we need to do from this first expression, whatever we have come up, like which is IDSP is equal to minus of IDSN. In that case, what I should do, I just need to flip in the this particular direction, like this vertically, I need to flip it. Okay, so if I'm flipping like this, In that case, the behavior will look like this one. And also because the I in, so from here, you can calculate the, from this expression. From this expression, I in will become V GSP plus VDD. Okay, so what you need to do? You need to add the VDD. So you will get the expression something like this one. Assuming that here, how you got 0 and 1.5? Just assuming that the VDD is equal to 2.5. Okay, for a simplification. Okay, so I'm considering the VDD is equal to 2.5. So if I will solve the equation for V in from here, so that will be VDD plus VGSP. So the graph will look like this one. So after the first change, the graph will look like this. Again, there is a mismatch in the quadrant, right? So in that case, what we need to do? We need to again shift this amount by this one, okay? So this zero need to be shifted to the VDD. Okay, from here, you can see here. Okay, so this zero need to be in one of the VDS, it is V out, and in another one, it is the V out minus VDD. So what we need to do, we need to shift it by the VDD. Okay, then for that purpose, what we need to do, simply just shift this scale in the right side by doing this. Okay, so V out will become VDD plus VDSP. So whatever the value you have, like zero will be added with the VDD. So this will come to here, and this point will come to here. Okay, so the resultant diagram will look like this. Now, if you see here, this both the graphs are in the same quadrant, and now you can superimpose these two things and you can get the real characteristics. Okay, so in case you have any doubt in this particular slide, let me ask, and because I'm moving to the next slide for the I'm superimposing these two things, and I will get some very good results and very good understanding about the circuit designs. So I'm giving you 1 minute to think about this, and then we can move ahead with this one. Do anyone have doubt on this? So if there is no doubt, we can move ahead with this one. Okay. So this is how we can transfer the IV characteristics of PMOS transistors to match up with the IV characteristics of the NMOS transistors. Now we both the characteristics are in the same quadrant, and after getting the both the transistors in the same quadrant, the both the ID VDS characteristics will look like this here.
Sir,
yeah.
Sorry, sir, could you go one slide back again?
Yeah, here.
Sir, that current I understood that drain and source, for P and N it is opposite, so we are reflecting in the axis.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The VGSP and VIN, that how did we change that?
Simply here. If you see here, from here, let me change the color of my marker. So here if you see, the VGSN is nothing but this is equal to VIN. And here, VGSP is nothing but is equal to V in minus VDD. Okay, so if I want to match these two things, what I need to do? So here V in is equal to VGSN, and if I want to calculate V in for the PMOS transistor, in that case I need to add this VDD. I need to add here, like I will shift here. So this V in for the PMOS transistor will become VGSP plus VDD, and that is why we have added to match these things, because to match the VGS of PMOS and NMOS, something like that, we need to add the VDD with the VGSP so that the we can have the same V in. Okay, because I'm providing the same input to both the transistors, and to match this I need to calculate the V in. So here after this expression, V in will become VGSP plus VDD, and this is the VGSP, and if I will add the VDD, and I'm considering the VDD is 0.5, so this will be shifted in the upward direction, like it was this VGS will become zero, and it will become something like 1.5, and if I'm shifting in the opposite direction, the graph will be something like this one.
Sir, we are considering VDD as 2.5, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, you got the answer?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So, let us move ahead. So after merging these two characteristics for PMOS and NMOS transistor, we are getting the characteristics something like this. Okay, what these characteristics indicates and what we can interpret out of this circuit. So let me explain one by one few things. If you see here, let me change the color first, then I will do it. Okay, either I can use a high here. See here, this graph, whatever the graph we are seeing, this graph is for the PMOS. Okay, and these graphs are for the NMOS transistors. Okay, now if you see here, I have this PMOS characteristics. Okay, these are the PMOS characteristics, and I need to find the points where the PMOS characteristics and the NMOS characteristics are crossing to each other. So if I'm seeing here, this PMOS transistor is crossing at this one, this NMOS transistor is crossing at this one. So I need to find the points at which these two are crossing. And if you somehow see, the majority of the crossings are either towards the zero side or towards the high side. So this is the 0 volt and this is the 2.5 volt. Let us assume the VDD is equal to 2.5. So the most of these crossings are either at the 0 volt or at the 2.5 volt. And if it is like this, in that case, we can say that the characteristics will be something like more ideal. So more it will be high, and there is a very less crossing in between. And if there is more crossing in between, means there will be less number of samples in between the transition, and you will get the low and high outputs. One more thing, if the population of this crossing is more towards to the zero and towards to the 2.5 or the VDD, you will get more sharper response, something like this. So the sharpness, that completely depends on how many samples we have in between, or how many samples or how many crossings we have at the higher side and at the lower side. Okay, so if we have more crossings at the higher and lower side, we will get more closer results. Okay, so this is really very important. Okay, so what this indicates? So the DC points, whatever we here, the Q point or the DC point, whatever we have, these are mostly towards the logic zero or towards the high. Okay, and what it means, it simply indicates that if the population of this crossing are mostly towards the high or low logic, it indicates that it exhibits that very narrow transition zone. And if the narrow transition zone is there, then sharp cutoff will be there. So we can move towards the more ideal characteristics. So how the device will behave, how the circuit will behave, that completely depends on where the crossing points are. If the crossing points are mostly towards the high and low, it will be the ideal one. Okay, so this is really important and that you should understand. Okay, so after getting these things, let me try to draw few things. Okay, is there any doubt? Okay, so if there is no doubt, let me so this I have merged it, and then we will come up with some output that will be something like this. So this is really very important slide, especially if you want to understand the characteristics of an inverter. Okay, so here we have the V output, here we have a V input. Okay. Now if you see here, let me change the color so that you will be easily understand. Okay, so this is how the inverter characteristics looks like. So here we have if we can recall the previous lecture, In the previous lecture, I indicated few points. This was the VOH, and the point where it was crossing, let us assume it is crossing to the zero, so it will be VOL. And I also told you, like, for better noise margin, VOL should be as small as possible. VOS should be as high as possible. Let me go back to that slide so that the doubt should be clear. Okay, so here if you see, if I will increase the VOL, and if I'm making this VOL close to ground, what it means, the noise margin will be increased. Similarly, if I'm making this VOS close to VDD, then the noise margin can be increased. Okay, so the noise margin depends on four factors. The first factor is the VOL, second factor is VOS, third factor is VIH, and the fourth factor is VIL. Okay, so if VOH is increasing, so I'm just making a simple statement, noise margin will increase if VOH is increasing, VOL is decreasing. And can anyone comment, what about the VIH and VIL?
Sir, if VIH is decreasing, then noise margin high, noise margin increases, and if VIL increases, then noise margin increases.
Perfect. So VIH need to be decreased and the VIL need to be increased. But remember one thing, this is really important. Yeah, so I got a very new things that need to be explained here. I forget to explain in the previous class. Okay, see here. The VOH is very easy, right? So VOH, the maximum VOH, that could be like VDD only. You cannot go beyond the VDD, whatever you have provided in any of the circuit. So the maximum limit could be like VDD. So this is perfectly fine. Similarly, for VOH, the minimum limit could be like zero. Okay, and you cannot beyond the zero because you have two, you have already provided two different voltage levels. One is the zero volt and the another one is the VDD. So you cannot decrease or increase this VOH and VOL beyond this boundary. Okay, so this VOH, the maximum limit or the minimum limit of this VOH can be zero, and this is perfectly fine. And for, and similarly for the VOS, the maximum limit is VDD. But the question is, like you are saying, the VIH should be small, and if I am reducing, you can increase the noise margin. So someone can ask, like, I'm just making a graph, something like this. This is the VDD, and let us assume this is the VIH. Okay, let me change the color, and here I have zero, and here I'm just making it like this, VIL. So you are saying that if somehow I can reduce this VIH, if somehow I can reduce this VIH and increase this VIL, I can increase the noise margin. But can you say something about what is the problem here? Can anyone guess what is the problem? You got the question, what I'm saying, what I'm explaining? Anyone, can anyone tell?
Sir, from the graph you have drawn on the left.
Left side one.
Sir, that blue graph of Vout versus Vin which you have drawn, then these characteristics won't be followed if VIL is greater than VIH.
Okay, so this kind of characteristics, so the VIH means simply, yeah, so this kind of characteristics you will never will achieve. Okay, and if this kind of characteristics will not be achieved, so this will not behave like an inverter, this will become a different kind of circuit. So the important thing is, important conclusion here is, even though to increase the noise margin, you can reduce the VIH and you can increase the VIL, but always the condition is the VIH must be always greater than or is equal to VIL to maintain the characteristics. Okay, so the VIH must be greater than or is equal to VIH. Okay, clear? Point is clear what I am explaining. Hoping that the things are clear. Okay, so let us go to the original slide which I was taking here. So we have drawn some characteristics, something like this. Okay, and let me draw a simple inverter circuit. Okay, so what I am doing, I am just giving the input like a ramp, and I am trying to observe the output behavior. Okay, so this is the VOH, VOL, something like that. Suppose if the input is less than threshold voltage. Okay, so where I can, if you can see here in this particular graph, we have some regions. Okay, this one is the, let me change the color. Here we have the region A, where I can clearly see that the output is maintaining logic high for certain period of time. There is one more region at the point where I am getting minus one slope. Okay, so minus one slope point is there, and that point is, let us assume it is B. Okay, another reason is in between. Yeah, so third could be here. Okay, I'm writing this as a D. Why D? I will tell you. This is also minus one slope point. Okay, this is the minus one slope point. This is also minus one slope point. And the reason in between B and D will be the C. Region C, which is the transition region. And the fourth region we have E, where I am getting the constant logic low. So if you see, if you observe these characteristics of inverter, we have five different regions. The first region is A, B, C, D, and E. So the region A and E are, these are completely visible, these are completely simple, like the input is very low, and if the input is very low, in that case, and if input is less than VTH, then this PMOS transistor will be activated. This PMOS transistor will be in the linear mode, and the NMOS transistor will be in the cutoff mode. Okay, so the important point is, let me make a table, and that will help you to understand. So I have only, so I will take 2 minutes more, then I will bind up this session. Okay, so I have to make a table like region V in, okay, V out, status of the transistors like NMOS and the PMOS. Okay, so let me make the complete table, so that will help you to understand them properly. Okay, so I have five regions: A, B, C, D, and E. In the region A, whatever I'm providing, the input is very low. Input is very low means it is less than VTH. Okay, and if it is less than VTH, in that case, the NMOS transistor will be in the cutoff region, and the PMOS transistor will be in the linear region. And at the same time, whatever output I will get the output, and that is equal to VOH. Okay. Now let us talk about the region E. Okay. So this is greater than VDD. Okay. So the here, what I'm providing, this is the greater than VDD plus VTH P, and here it is N. Because VTS of P is negative, so if it is greater than VDD minus actual voltage, in that case, the NMOS transistor will be in the linear region, and the PMOS transistor will be in the cutoff region. Can anyone tell, like, how I wrote this VDD plus VTHN? Because the threshold voltage of the PMOS transistor is negative, and if it is negative, like VDD minus actual value, let us assume the VTHP mod is 0.2. Okay, actually this is negative, but modulus is 0.2. So what I need to do, VDD minus 0.2. So if it is input is greater than VDD minus 0.2, in that case, this will be in the linear and this will be in the cutoff region. Okay, so that is why I wrote here positive, because the VTH for the PMOS is negative. Okay, so this is all about this one. Now, the second thing is, like, region B. In the region B, I will take two more minutes. Host, please wait for 2 more minutes, because I just wanted to close these things, whatever I'm teaching. So in this case, the V input will be VIL. Here, if you see region B, so this point is nothing but this is the VIL, and this point is the VIH. So the input will be VIL, and in that case, whatever output I will get, I will get output close to VOH. Okay, so this will be the close to VOH or high. And in this case, the NMOS transistor will be in the saturation. Like, just apply all these things and you will get like the NMOS. So this is the homework to find, like, how I am saying this is the in saturation and the other device is in the linear one. Okay, so this is the homework. Just by calculating the condition, like VDS is equal to greater than or is equal to VTS minus VDS, something like that. Whatever the relation we have studied, just go through it and you will get to know that the NMOS, after applying all these conditions, the NMOS transistor will be in the saturation region. Similarly, if the input is equal to VM, okay, so this region C, VM is nothing but the threshold voltage of the circuit. So if it is like that, output will also be equal to VM. So input and outputs are crossing to each other here. And in this case, both the transistors will be in the saturation. And this will also be in the saturation. And similarly, for the last one, if I'm providing the input which is close to VIH, I will get the output which is the VOL here. Okay, so the D is close to VOL. So I will get VOL, this is close to VOL. And in this case, this transistor will be in the linear and this one will be in the saturation. So the homework is just in the next week or okay, tomorrow we have lecture. So no, we don't have tomorrow lecture. So on next week, just come with the answer of all these questions, like how I have kept this different region of NMOS and PMOS transistors. And just calculate with the expression whatever we studied before and try to check whether the really device will be in the linear saturation or in the cutoff region. Okay, so I'm closing the session here only. Thank you so much for attending the lecture.